About Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.
Good evening, and welcome to the Berks County Kennel Club's program, All About Dogs. Hi, I'm Pat Mock, your host, and it's March already, so I have terriers for you. Actually, they're Bedlington Terriers. So my guests this evening are Diane Pearson and Tisha Palmer, and they're going to tell us actually what these cute little lamb-looking dogs are, where they came from. Diane, you want to tell us where these came from?
Bedlingtons are from England, most of the terrier breeds, right? Bred to eliminate vermin on an island that has nowhere for them to go.
Okay.
So they were established as a breed in the very early 1800s from a combination of other terriers. Did a variety of jobs. And the first one, I think, was owned by a gentleman named Joseph Ainsley in Bedlington, England, which is how the breed got their name.
Okay, from the town.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, yep. Okay.
They were used by a large variety of people, an everyman's dog, if you will.
Okay.
They can hunt rabbits and put food on the table. They can rid mines of rats. They were sometimes said to be a poacher's dog. They're very fast. They're an above-ground terrier. They're a little too big to go to ground in most burrows.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But above ground, they might hunt fox or badger, that sort of thing.
Okay. Were they supposed to actually, were they bred for just one specific task to start with?
No? They're very much an all-purpose terrier. Mm-hmm. You know, just
stop.
If it needs to be killed, kill it.
Okay. Well, is that what they did when they were used for hunting?
Yes.
They did kill the...
Yes.
They did? Oh, wow. Okay. Well, that was, I guess, convenient.
even in modern day, we've got a gentleman who takes a group of terrier owners, among them. Mm-hmm. He's got someone with a Bedlington, and they hunt rats in Manhattan.
Okay. Yes, I think I saw that. I think I saw it on television.
You will have. He's done several different television shows. He just taped one, I think, for a show in Sweden.
Okay.
This past week.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's their job.
Wow.
That was the job they had to do.
Yeah.
So.
Now, they're an odd-looking breed.
Yes.
Distinctive looking.
Okay. They're a distinctive-looking breed. But anyhow, why was there whippet bred into them that they have the roached back?
You know, I went to one of our to a book that was written on the history of the breed by someone very, very highly respected in England, and he said as much as that there's a theory that, you know, that there's whippet, he never found any proof of it. But they do have a naturally roached top line.
Right.
You know, that's not just the haircut. They do a double suspension gallop, like a sighthound would.
That's right.
And many people, especially, you know, our folks, when we meet them at dog shows and we're out for walks, they ask, well, is the head shaped like that?
Oh, yeah.
And it's not.
Right.
The head has a very, very slight stop.
Well.
So just the littlest bit.
It looks like a bull terrier. So
exactly.
I would think that, you know, people think it's just, you know, a hairy bull terrier.
Right. Now, that's interesting because he actually did think, that historian did think, that there might have been bull terrier mixed in.
Really?
For tenacity, strength and tenacity, right?
Screws.
But when we discuss this haircut with people, you know, we say, well, the reason that this hair is cut so narrow is so they can still see, right? Now we fluff them up for the TV show.
Sure.
This coat naturally is somewhat curly,
right?
Has a natural curl to it. You can see some of that coming through in his head. So we trim it narrow, but we leave hair on the top of the nose so that if they're going to bite something and it wants to bite back, it gets a mouthful of hair.
Right.
And if you watch puppies play, when the puppies play, the tassels flying around are an attractant, and they bite the tassel instead of the ear. So there is there's a rhyme and reason, a purpose for that trim.
Okay.
You know.
So then the tassel is at the end of the ear.
Yep.
It's not really on
the tip of it, on
the leather.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
And you know, here in the United States, we tend to exaggerate things a little bit. So the tassels are a little smaller and finer.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just enough to be a distraction. You know, to an animal like a badger, a fox, or a groundhog that might decide to turn and stand.
Right.
You know?
So it's actually, well, The tail is shaved as well, or the tail is the rat tail?
Nope, the tail is shaved.
Okay.
We refer to it as a rat tail, but the tail is shaved. It would have almost a wire coat on it because their coat is a mix of a soft, linty hair and also a wire, crisp wire coat mixed in. And the tail grows in almost wire coated. But I think we shave the tail. They're not a breed that would ever get pulled out of a hole by the tail, so it's never docked, right? And we shave it, and I think that we do it primarily for sanitary reasons.
Okay, okay, all right. But it definitely is an odd. Now, if you didn't cut them, how long would the coat actually, what would they look like if you didn't groom them?
Because the coat is such a mix of the soft coat with the wire coat, it mats easily.
Okay.
And so they'd look like a very hairy, matted dog.
Oh.
They would. It would, you know, it's just for the sake of the dog and their comfort, keeping it shorter, if anything, is better than letting it get long. And, a lot of my pet owners will trim their dogs very short on the body and leave the typical head, the typical look for the breed.
Right.
But everything else, the legs and the head shorter so that they're not dealing with, a lot of upkeep.
Right, right. Mm-hmm. Now, the white one is the female.
So we have three colors and two marking patterns in Bedlingtons.
Okay.
And I wanted to bring you an example of them. So over there, Gilbert is a blue Bedlington. He was born black. All right. Cruz here is a liver Bedlington. He was born dark brown.
Okay.
As an adult, the skin color is different. This skin color is pinkish brown. His skin color is gray. He has very dark brown eyes and a black nose, so black pigment. Cruz's pigment, because it's a brown, has a brown nose and a hazel eye.
Okay.
So when he's in color, all right, and Bedlingtons change color all the time their whole lives, which is kind of a fun thing.
Oh.
Okay. When he's in color, he's a light taupe along the sides. The head and legs should always be lighter.
Okay.
The standard requires the head to be lighter. Doesn't have to be white, but it's to be lighter, and usually the legs. Cruz. Dasha's here, partly because she's an import from Russia.
Okay.
She's not American bred. She is a blue and tan. So when we look at still pictures, you'll see it. She had tan points as a puppy, like a Doberman or Rottweiler would have. She had tan eyebrows, tan cheeks, tan paws.
Oh.
As the colors fade, they all blend into the lighter coat, and you don't see it anymore.
Wow.
So we have blue, liver, and sandy, which is another shade of brown. And we have blue and tan, liver and tan, and sandy and tan.
Okay, so you know when they're puppies, actually, what color they're going to be as adults.
Yes,
hi.
We do.
Hello to you, too.
Yes, we do. Stop.
What are you looking for? But you also shave...
More camera time, please. More camera time.
Underneath the ears and down the throat as well.
We do. No reason, hunting-wise, probably just because it looks clean and neat. Best I can say for the
I guess it's easier. If they kill the prey, it's probably easier to wash the blood off. Isn't that gross?
And, if we're going to shave the head narrow so they can see, then we want to take that symmetry all the way back to behind the ear. So that's what we do.
Okay.
The haircut varies around the world to a degree.
Really?
Yes.
Yeah.
In England, much shorter, as I said. Much less coat on the legs, on the body. In England and in Sweden, they take this head and they almost make a bubble behind and shave the neck down very, very short. So here in the United States, we leave kind of a little mane, right? But in Europe and in England, it's a very different haircut.
I would think that would be, this would be more pleasing.
I kind of like the bubble head. I play with it. That's one of the fun things about this breed. You can play with the haircut.
Right.
I knew someone that grew their Bedlington's coat out and colored her with, dog safe dyes to look like a horse, a pony.
Oh my.
She grew a long mane.
Yes. Yes.
She grew long hair down at the feet like a Clydesdale would have and colored her body.
Yeah.
So you can have some fun with this trim.
Yes. Yes. But then it all washes out.
It does.
So as far as a dog for a pet, would this breed be good with, say, kids?
So I think they're a great dog for children, not baby children.
Well, no.
Okay,
right, right.
Not tiny children.
Like five and up.
I don't have children, so I can't give you an age range because I have no personal experience with it. But what I tell my puppy buyers that inquire, I say, it's not a Labrador Retriever.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a dog that is going to want or tolerate having its ears pulled and its tail pulled and mm-hmm. that sort of thing. So if you have well-behaved children, and I have families that got their first Bedlington when they had no children, and mm-hmm. I have one family that has five.
Yes.
So their children have all grown up with their dog, mm-hmm. and they've been a very successful home.
Yes.
Okay. But I think very much depends on the owners mm-hmm. and the family.
Right.
I've had Bedlingtons be returned to me, come back to me, or have me help rehome them because the owners found that once they started having children, they didn't have the time to devote to the dog that it deserved, mm-hmm. right? And I have a lot of respect for them
yes.
to coming to that decision. It broke their hearts.
Right.
Okay,
right.
It wasn't something they came to lightly. And the dogs are in very happy homes, you know, mm-hmm. and I'm glad they reached out to me. So are they a dog for children? I'd say for a little bit older children, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I have a nephew, when I had my first two Bedlingtons, I lived with my sister. He would come to the house. He was rather a wild boy, okay? He's still kind of a wild young adult. And I had one dog who loved a ball.
Okay.
Oh my gosh, she was insane for a ball. And he would throw the ball. He didn't care if it hit a lamp or a vase or anything else. He just threw the ball.
Yes.
She loved him and would play with him for hours. My other dog, my other Bedlington, thought he was just a little loud and a little much, and he would just very quietly go lie under the dining room table and make himself scarce.
Okay.
Not afraid of him, just, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I don't need to interact.
Right,
and
right.
as long as he was given the space to do that, mm-hmm, it worked mm-hmm. out fine.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, what about with seniors, like in a retirement community? Because it is about the size. How much do they weigh? Now, he's the biggest. How much does he weigh?
Well, he's in full show coat, so he looks a little fluffier, too.
Uh-huh.
He weighs 22 and a half pounds.
Okay.
Just Adam Wade.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So the standard says 17 to 23.
Okay.
Here in the United States, as I said, we like things bigger and better, mm-hmm, right? We mm-hmm. feed them well, mm-hmm. right? He's in great muscle. He's in great muscle too. So 17 to 23, she's a very small little girl, so she's probably at the bottom end of that mm-hmm. or a little mm-hmm. below.
Yes.
Cruz is probably a 19 or 20 pound dog easily, you know.
So that would be, you know, the weight range for people in a senior community.
Yeah.
So are they barkers?
They can be.
Okay.
A lot depends on the individual.
Okay.
Dasha's a little bit of a woo-woo-woo dog, mm-hmm, all right? She's a very distinctive bark.
Mm-hmm.
And I have others that are pretty quiet. So very, you know, they have, everybody's got their own personality. You know, mm-hmm. But they can be.
Okay.
I wouldn't say they're excessive barkers most of the time. If they see a squirrel or a rabbit in the yard, that's the trigger.
Yes.
That's the kind of thing that will trigger them.
Right.
You know, the mailman comes to the door and knocks, they'll bark, but they, mm-hmm. but you know, they won't go on for an hour.
Okay.
You know, I think they'd be a great dog for something like a nursing home. The difficulty would be the high maintenance. They're high maintenance.
Yeah.
Right.
So as long as someone that works there is willing to do the brushing, the combing, mm-hmm. and do the maintenance
right.
on them,
right.
they love people. They certainly wouldn't be fazed by wheelchairs or crutches or mm-hmm. you know, any of that mm-hmm. sort of thing.
Yeah.
And they're very social.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So yeah, I think that would be a great
fit
for them.
It's most of the terriers. I think most of the terriers mm-hmm. are very social.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
But yeah. Now, how about if we see some pictures? I think we have a picture of which one is a puppy?
We have a couple.
Oh, okay.
There's Gilbert.
That's your dog.
That's recent.
That's Gilbert. He just finished his bronze grand championship.
Oh, wow. Wonderful. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi.
Yes.
That's Dasha as a younger dog. So you see how dark she is.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Right. She's changing from being the black puppy to being the very dark gray with the lighter head and legs.
Right, right. In fact, her head looks almost white and mm-hmm. the legs look almost white.
Mm-hmm.
Right, right.
That's Dasha at her dog show.
Oh.
A little bit lighter there, a little bit older.
Yes, yes.
That's Dasha as a puppy. So that's where you see the blue and tan.
Oh, yes. You can see the brown legs. Yes.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And she's got kind of tan points on her shoulders.
Mm-hmm.
Harder to see the cheek patches and eyebrows, but they're there.
Right.
Yep.
And she really, you can see the head because she doesn't have as much hair on the face
right.
as a puppy, you know, that you can actually see that there is a little bit of a stop there.
Yep.
But. That's your
Gilbert
dog.
Lorcoursing.
Yes, yes.
They're very fast. Right. Very. How what's his top speed?
Right now, he has AKC's fastest lifetime fast cat for Bedlingtons.
Oh, wow.
With a three-run average of 27.4 miles per hour.
Wow.
They're fast.
Yes, they are. Yes, they are.
I think this is a
but
series.
You can see. I mean, he's not. He doesn't even have his feet on the ground.
So none double, of them. Yeah, exactly.
That double suspension.
Yeah, double suspension.
Right. Yep. That's like the Whippets, you know, of the Greyhounds. You know, they go. You know.
Right.
But, there he goes.
Oh. What the heck was that? He caught the
bag.
Oh,
okay.
The
end, yes.
Yeah. Caught the bag.
Sort of like a face plant as well.
Exactly. That's the exuberance.
These are puppies playing outside. Those are a bunch of liver puppies.
Okay.
So they're brown.
Mm-hmm.
You can see the ears flying. That's Gilbert doing scent work, right?
Okay. Yep. Yes. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Obviously, that's I found it look. Yes.
Yes. The I found it look.
And that's a boy that I sent to Sweden. He won 3 months after he went, he won Best of Breed at the World Dog Show.
Oh, wow. Isn't that wonderful?
He was a lovely, lovely boy.
Yeah, yeah. Right.
That's Brighton, who I meant to bring today.
Okay, okay.
She's a liver girl.
Uh-huh. You say liver, but you can't really...
You tell by the nose and the
yes,
eye color.
That's exactly right.
You can tell when they're puppies.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, one of the interesting things about the females, when they come in season, they get darker.
Really?
Yes. They do.
Oh my.
So when I was bathing Brighton in preparation for bringing her to the show, I bathed her and I used the Force Air Force dryer, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm like, your roots are getting a little dark. You know, the roots of her hair were getting a little dark.
Well, isn't that interesting?
Yeah. Good boy. It's kind of an early warning system.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's nice.
It helps, you know.
Right. But then after she's, excuse me, after she's in season, then the hair gets lighter
again? A couple months later, yeah, the roots will lighten up again. It's kind of a cycle.
If you injure the skin for any reason, it grows back in the puppy color, and you have to wait as it ages
to
lighten back up.
Yep.
It is allowed in the show ring if it's honorable scars, you know, from being a terrier.
Yeah. So what actually can these dogs do other than hunting at fast cat and confirmation, of course?
A little of anything. For a terrier, I think, find them very biddable. Mm-hmm. They like to learn. This one does obedience and rally.
Okay.
And he loves learning tricks. So we did all the trick dogs.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're starting to train in agility.
Oh, very good.
And he's 3.5.
Okay.
We've done a lot of nose work in a short period of time, as well as the show ring. And, he really enjoyed doing all of the companion dog titles, you know, doing the CGC and the farm dog certified and the temperament testing.
Okay.
Just is another way to push the limits of socialization and making sure that he can handle those things.
That's great.
And we had a lot of fun.
That's great.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm insane. I know.
Who's there? Cruise.
You can see his reflection.
Yes. Or somebody walked past. Yeah. But that's really it's interesting that a terrier would want to stay with you for obedience.
Yeah, he has taught me to be a better trainer.
Yes, they usually do.
Yes, because a lot of people in the obedience world train with border collies. And I had to learn real quickly that he's not a working breed. He does not want to do it 12 times.
Right.
He wants to do it one time well, and then we stop while we're ahead.
Mm-hmm.
He's a fast learner, and repetition just makes him
insane. Bored.
Yeah, makes him bored.
That's exactly
and a
right.
bored terrier is not a good...
Right. Then they figure out their own thing
exactly.
to do.
He'll add something extra to the game you let him.
Yes.
So, yeah.
So I think you brought videos as well.
I did. There should be some puppy videos.
Oh, okay. Can we see the puppy video? Oh, now you can see how tan, the tan coat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This is Gilbert.
Oh, okay.
That's the fast
doing
cat.
Doing the fast cat.
Mm-hmm.
Easy bubble.
Yeah, he's almost catching it.
Who do you see?
There we go. Whoa.
Thank goodness that white plastic bags are cheap, right?
Yes.
Because he's a bag shredder.
There's the puppies playing.
Okay.
So you see Born Dark.
Uh-huh.
There's a liver puppy at the front there.
Right.
And a blue puppy wrestling in the back.
Mm-hmm.
Also in the far background.
Yes, yes.
Give them their first haircuts when they're about 5 weeks old.
Really? Wow.
You know, we see owners that sometimes say, you know, oh, my Bedlington is 6 months old. When should I get its first haircut? And I cringe because I'm like, they have to have this done their whole lives.
Right.
So let's get them started early and get them used to it and let them know it's nothing that's going to hurt them or anything.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, I start at 5 weeks old giving them their haircuts.
Oh, this has been playing in the agility tunnel.
Yeah, we do lots of, you know, as puppies, lots of enrichment, lots of, you know, interesting surfaces.
Mm-hmm. Montessori school.
Yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, play sets things that in the foreground is what's supposed to be a cat bed from IKEA. It folds up. But they'll pile in there and play and roll with each other. There goes Dasha playing with them.
Mm-hmm.
And then they'll tumble out, and it's kind of like watching a clown car. How many are going to come out of that thing?
Yes.
You know, that's another one of my girls.
Mm-hmm.
She's like, she's being a bit pushy.
Yeah.
Just a bit pushy.
Well, it fell over on them.
Yeah. Oh, that thing had to get tossed. They shredded it.
Oh,
they're terriers.
Mm-hmm.
they can be destructive. This is Dasha playing with one of the puppies, kind of teaching them how to play.
Oh, these are her puppies?
Yeah.
Okay.
That was her first litter.
Okay.
I remember when I first saw Bedlington's play, I was amazed at the sound.
Oh, yeah.
I know this is a quiet video, but they sound like an angry hive of bees.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
And they also like to really, really play with their mouths.
Mm-hmm,
I call it bitey face.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
Yeah.
I know what that is. I know what that is.
Come here.
So how often do you have to groom them?
I usually tell people every 6 to 8 weeks.
Okay.
Just like people, you know, some people's hair grows faster and some slower.
Mm-hmm.
And it also depends, too, on what you're doing with them, what the weather's like.
Uh-huh,
you know,
uh-huh.
If it's rainy, wet, or snowy, you're going to need to groom them and trim them more often because the hair will mat when it gets wet.
Okay.
You know?
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
It mats easily, and they go out in the snow. They'll get balls on their feet, you know, big snowballs on stick
sure,
to their
because
coat.
Because of the soft coat.
Right. So once it dries, you really need to brush and comb through. And I always stress with my owners, you know, we use a nice slicker brush.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I say, okay, yeah, you brush. But then after you brush, you always need to follow with a comb.
Mm-hmm.
Because the brush just smooths out the top, the surface.
Right.
And you need to make sure you get down to the roots to make sure there's nothing that'll snag that. So that's a really important tip for my, you know, for my pet owners.
Well, the nice thing is you don't have to groom behind the ears.
The whole dog is, though. The ears are shaved. Everything behind the ears is shaved or scissored or trimmed.
Because that's usually where they're kind of mad,
and
behind
the
ears.
I have pet owners that have learned to groom their own dogs.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's an investment by the time you buy the clippers and the scissors and
the
table and everything. But at the same time, when you consider what you pay a professional groomer every, let's say, 8 weeks for 15 years, that investment pays off.
Are there that many groomers that actually know how to do a Bedlington?
They look at the books,
mm-hmm.
But one of the most common questions we see, we have a couple different Facebook groups that are for Bedlington owners in general, and one of the most common questions is, where can I find a groomer that knows how to do this trim?
Yes.
I've met several groomers at dog shows, you know, by arrangement to help show them. Let me give you tips. You know, comb the whole head this way, go up the side of the face, comb the whole head back over, go up the side of the face, comb it straight back up, cut off the point on the middle.
Right.
I think the biggest issue that we see
hair floating around
is they read the book and it says, there we go, Bedlington coat. It says, go to the top of the ear and then groom the head to that same length, right? But they stop where the cartilage is on the outside.
Okay.
They don't go past that cartilage to the actual
to the
skull
of the ear. Right.
Then the whole head's too wide.
Yes.
They try to do the whole head that length, and they're like, it's too wide. The dog can't see.
Right.
They
right.
end up cutting out the face and the muzzle, and it kind of looks like a light bulb.
Oh.
So that's the biggest flaw that we see with pet grooming is they don't get enough. We breed under 200 Bedlingtons a year in the United States.
Right.
So they're a very rare breed in that respect. Mm-hmm. So the professional groomers don't get a chance to see them very often.
Right. You know? Well, does this breed need a lot of exercise? I would assume a fenced yard is almost required.
A fenced yard is absolutely for the best.
Yes.
Right? I have dogs that live in Manhattan, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. That get lots of good walks
right.
and do fine. Mm-hmm. I'd say that amount of exercise is much more critical with a puppy to keep them from being destructive,
yes.
right? To keep them,
yep.
we always say,
make them tired.
Tired puppy's a good
mm-hmm.
puppy,
mm-hmm.
right? So that's important. As an adult, these guys, one of the most wonderful things about the breed is, if you come home and say, let's go for a walk, they're mm-hmm. like, yeah, let's go for a walk. If you come home and say, man, it was a rough day today at work, let's watch something on Netflix, they'll cuddle up on the couch with you and watch
okay.
something on Netflix.
Okay. Yes, I noticed they are extremely affectionate. They
oh,
want to
yeah.
really be basically on you.
On your people.
Yes.
I describe them as a Velcro dog, right? So... You
alarm.
Definitely, you know, having had Borzoi before, I had this breed. I know. We can. You see yourselves. You see yourselves. If they would kind of look up, they'd be laying on the floor in the living room, and they'd look up. Oh, you're in the house. Okay, it's cool.
Mm-hmm.
It's cool. You know,
mm-hmm.
we're close enough. The Bedlingtons. If you're in another room, they want to be in that room.
Yes.
No. Yeah. It's okay.
So what?
Papa. Papa.
What health problems do they have?
Historically. Copper mm-hmm. toxicosis was the big one. We call it CT or copper toxicosis. There's
okay.
a disease in humans called Wilson's disease.
Okay.
That basically prevented breeders from possibly being able to get ahead of it, because until modern day DNA testing, they would do surgical liver biopsies.
Okay.
They had to
wow.
wait till the dogs were over a year old.
Yes.
Do the biopsy. By then, you've made your pick, you've kept your breeding
yes,
stock, and
yes.
you may have just not
right,
gotten anywhere
right,
ahead.
Right.
With the
right.
DNA marker test, we can test four-week-old puppies.
Wow.
And so we've done a wonderful job, I think,
I gotcha.
Breeders,
oh,
in
yeah.
eliminating
yeah.
that in the United States.
So that would be an excellent reason
Cruise.
To, if
Cruise.
You want a Bedlington, call the Berks County Kennel Club, and I will send you to a Bedlington breeder, because these ladies are fairly local. So they would be more than happy to help you find a dog. And that is one reason why you should buy from a reputable breeder. Otherwise, I'm sure anybody else who is just breeding things that look like Bedlingtons are not going to health test. So that is one of the main reasons to buy from a reputable breeder, because we're going to keep one of those dogs. So anyhow. So I want to thank my guests this evening, and that's our program for tonight. So for this evening, good night.
All About Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.